الله الرحمن الرحيم. الدكتور زاك فور ذا اورجنايزنج كوميتي فور انفايتنج مي تو شير ان ذيس ايفنت. Dear chairpersons, ladies and gentlemen, we will discuss today an important issue which is benign fibroid embolization. Why, when, and how we can do the embolization. First of all, we should have everything, all the tools in the box. We should have myomectomy, hysterectomy, medical treatment, and also we should have another tool which is a trial after embolization. We should know that the practice recommendation from the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists states that uterine artery embolization is evidence-based medicine level A. It is not investigational tool. It is already well established safe tool for the treatment of uterine fibroids. This is in 2011 a systematic review and meta-analysis for uterine artery embolization versus surgery in the treatment of symptomatic fibroids. And it concluded that uterine artery embolization is safe and effective, and it should be one of the tools for the treatment of uterine fibroids. We go for uterine artery embolization not only for uterine fibroids, but for other utilizations like postpartum hemorrhage, which is a life-saving procedure, and also for post-surgical hemorrhage. Sometimes in pelvic malignancies, when the tumor invades one of the arterial territories, in pelvic traumas with massive pelvic bleeding, and also for what is called pelvic arteriovenous malformation. Some facts about uterine fibroids. We all know that it's a benign tumor. It's more common in black women. The age of presentation from 20 to 40 years old, and it is extremely common. About 40% of women may have uterine fibroid, and most of the time uterine fibroids are asymptomatic. Asymptomatic patient does not require any treatment, and it is still present the most common indication for hysterectomy. We all know the type of uterine fibroids. We have the submucous type, the subserous, and the interstitial, and we are concerned also with two other types, pedunculated submucous and pedunculated subserous. Why? Because the pedunculated subserous with long, small pedicle is a contraindication for the embolization. What is the presentation of uterine fibroids? This is the most important presentation for us, patient with abnormal uterine bleeding. Patient present with menorrhagia, metrorrhagia, or menometrorrhagia, whatever the combination, is menorrhea. This is the most important candidate to uterine artery embolization, and this will benefit more rather than patients with other symptoms from the uterine artery embolization. We have other symptoms like pelvic pressure symptoms. The fibroid may compress the renal bladder, leading to frequency of micturition, or compress the rectum, leading to constipation or dyspareunia. Also, we have sometimes deep-seated pelvic pain, and we may have reproductive dysfunction, inability to conceive, recurrent abortions, or premature delivery. As a radiologist, we are all concerned about the imaging modalities for fibroids. We have the B-mode imaging ultrasound, that is the most commonly used, and we all know the appearance of hypochoric large lesion with the appearance in the uterus. And also, more recently, we have the contrast-enhanced ultrasound. And we go also for other investigations like transvaginal ultrasound, sonohysterography, and sometimes we can go for transperineal approach to see the extension of the fibroid along the cervix. This is the picture of Bauer Doppler showing the increased vascularity within the fibroid. And this picture denotes that the lesion will respond extremely efficient for the embolization. Sometimes we measure the peak systolic velocity in the uterine arteries, and this will correlate with the number of vials injected in the procedure. Till now, we are trying to convince the gynecologist we have another tool for the diagnosis of the pelvic lesions in the female, which is the MRI. The MRI is considered now the most accurate imaging technique for the detection and the localization of the fibroids. If activity assess the presence, whether it is present or not, the number, the size, the location, and also the character of this myoid. These are the images of the MRI. This is the appearance of the T1 surgical images, intermediate signal intensity, low signal intensity is the T2, and most of the time, homogeneous contrast are taken after contrast injection. Since the static image, not like the ultrasound, which is a dynamic one, we can extremely assess the size in an extremely precise manner, and we can see also the number of the fibroids. After contrast injection, we can have less contrast uptake, and this patient will not benefit from the embolization, partial contrast uptake, and diffuse homogeneous uptake. The MRI also is an extremely valuable tool to convince the referring physician. As we can see, this is a static image pre-embolization and 1 year after embolization. There is remarkable degradation of the site of the fibroid. The global uterine size markedly decreased after the embolization. Another example for important issue, which is considered for some as a complication, and we consider it as an extremely beneficial tool, which is called expulsion of the submucous fibroid after embolization, regression in size, expulsion from the cervix, and some people call it uterine artery embolization myomectomy. This is also the value of the MRI to evaluate whether there is recurrence or not. You can see this was before embolization. After embolization, there is still enhancing part of the fibroid. This is recurrence after 1 year. Very important issue for the diagnostic radiologist also is to assess whether there is infection or not. This is a case of endometritis, marginal peripheral enhancement with air pockets within the uterus, and the most important, the patient is in a toxic status. Not only the presence of air, but also the clinical appearance of the patient. MRI also will assess whether there is associated adenomyosis or not, whether it is diffuse or focal, asymmetrical or symmetrical, and previously adenomyosis was a contraindication for the embolization, but more recently, we are the short-term and the long-term studies, we can do the embolization for patients with adenomyosis. This is the typical appearance of the uterine artery in the diagnostic angiography, and we go for the diagnostic angiography not as a diagnostic tool, but only in the therapeutic setup. This is typical appearance, called screw appearance, descending portion, transverse, ascending portion, and these are sequential images, and this is the right side uterine artery, and this is the typical appearance of the pathological branches supplying the fibroid. Sometimes you can go for 3D conventional angiography during the embolization procedure to identify the origin of the artery. And these are the appearance of the pathological vessels supplementing the uterine fibroids in a 3D manner. Sometimes also you can go for what is called MR and X-ray fusion. These are the left uterine axis. And this is after fusion with the MRI images. We can see also that the right uterine artery giving pathological branches exactly to the large fibroids. What are the available treatment? The already well established treatment, there is the medical treatment, which is the hormonal treatment, GnRH analog, myomectomy, myolysis, and if this measures fail, we go for hysterectomy. The more recent, less invasive treatment is uterine artery embolization, and another thing which is called the high intensity focused ultrasound, which is another tool to focus the ultrasound beams and to ablate the uterine fibroids. Why to do uterine artery embolization? Uterine artery embolization can go for patients with symptomatic fibroids, whether single or multiple, whether submucous or subserosal or whatever presentation, except for subserous fibroid with long pedicle, patients seeking uterine scaling and rapid recovery. Also, if there is any contraindication for general anesthesia, sometimes before myomectomy to reduce the risk of bleeding. In the actual setting, the gynecologist will send the patient to us to do uterine artery embolization. He will send the patient whether there is previous myomectomy and recurrence of the fibroid, patients with large cervical fibroids and there is an extreme fear of hysterectomy during the operation. Patients with marked adhesions in the pelvis, so they will not be able to do myomectomy. Obese patient, extremely obese patient. Patient with multiple associated comorbidities. These are the indications when the gynecologist will refer the patient for the uterine artery embolization. The contraindications might be contrast allergy, renal impairment, with uncreated, as we mentioned, uncreated subserous fibroid, and active genital infection. The uterine artery is a branch of the internal iliac artery of the anterior division, supplying not only the uterus, but also, it supplies also the part of the ureter and also gives sometimes pure arterial supply to the ovary. Sometimes the ovarian artery play a significant role in contributing to supply the fibroid. So this may explain sometimes failed procedure despite proper embolization of the uterine artery. What is the concept of embolization? The fibroid will enlarge the uterine arteries and will divert much of the flow towards the fibroid. So we are using what is called PVA particles or embosphere with a size 500 to 700 at least. This will go selectively to the enlarged pathological vessels directed by the size and also directed by the flow. I will not discuss in detail the procedure, but it is like all the endovascular procedures, puncture from the common femoral artery, and we will select the right and left uterine arteries, and we will go for the embolization with the endosphere. As I mentioned, we will never use microparticles less than 500, and we will go upgrading the size up to 700, 900 micron, and up to 1,000 microns. And for us, the technical endpoint is the stasis of contrast in both uterine arteries for 10 cardiac beats. This is our incision, about five millimeter. No, this is just the introduction of the sheath with the patient. No other incisions are done for this procedure. And this is the embolizing material, what we are using. This is the microparticles, and sometimes we can go for the gel foam bleached, and we must use this bleached in cases of postpartum hemorrhage. We have two different types in the market from the embosphere, non-calibrated particles and the calibrated particles. For the calibrated particles, we will never use less than 700 microns to avoid penetration deep into the myometrium. This is the concept of embolization, because the patient is asking you, what will occur for my fibroid? This is a size before the embolization. There will be reduction in size of the fibroid in situ and fibrosis. It will not disappear, but we will gain reduction of the size up to 70% at 1 year post-embolization. This is a real example for contribution of the ovarian artery. This is also the typical appearance of the ovarian artery, this is the right ovarian artery, and contribution to the fibroid, and this may explain why this fibroid didn't shrink after the primary embolization of the uterine artery. We should pay attention, not every blush is a uterine fibroid. Sometimes we have what is called arterial venous malformation, and in this patient we will not use microparticles, we will use a radically polymerizing agent which is called histoacryl or onyx to occlude this arterial venous malformation to avoid rapid shunting of the embolizing material to the lung. What is the outcome of uterine fibroid? As I mentioned, it will control patients with menorrhagia in about 80 to 90% of the cases. Less percentage for patients with bulk related symptoms, 83%. There is about reduction of the size of the fibroid, about 50% at 6 months, and about 70% at 1 year post-embolization. The only drawbacks is 10% remote recurrence of symptoms, that the patient will have rapid recovery, and there is still worldwide question about fertility. I will only show you some evidence about fertility. This was what is called the Ontario Multicentric Study, and it stated that women are able to achieve pregnancies after uterine artery embolization. Other evidences, this was 56 pregnancies after embolization. And this is the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists concluded that uterine artery embolization is safe and effective option for selected women who wish to retain their uterine. Also recommend caution when considering embolization for future effect. Also, the evidence suggests that women with desired pregnancy or experience of fertility or recurrent miscarriage due to fibroids and are unsuitable for hysteroscopic resection or myomectomy, and when myomectomy fails, can be offered uterine artery embolization as a safe and effective alternative. And every time we shall tailor the procedure for every patient and discuss it on a case by case discussion, and we'll explain all the procedure for the patient. This is in 2011, a study done by Bishop et al. Pregnancy after uterine embolization, and they concluded that pregnancy after uterine artery embolization appears to be safe. There was also a controlled study, a randomized controlled study, with a double arm between myomectomy and uterine artery embolization, and they concluded that uterine artery embolization is also safe and effective for patients seeking future fertility. Another issue, whether to do uterine artery embolization for fibroids more than 10 centimeters in size. This was a study done in 2014, and there was no difference as regarding the size and the quality of life and the global uterine size in between the two groups. This was a double-arm study also between patients has fibroid, had fibroids less than 10 centimeters and patients had fibroids more than 10 centimeters. So they concluded that uterine artery embolization can be offered for patients with fibroids larger than 10 centimeters. This are gallery for some patients. This is a large fibroid supplied mainly by the right uterine artery, and this is the picture post embolization. Another patient with large fibroid. This is the corresponding MR images, and it appears nearly the same like the left uterine artery injection at the angiography. Another patient, and this is the MR before and after. We can see there is global regression of the uterine size, and the fibroid is less in size with necrotic appearance. And in general, when we follow up the patient for uterine fibroid, there is a regression in the size and less contrast enhancement. This is the contrast enhanced ultrasound, regressed in size with lack of contrast uptake. The same for the MRI follow up after the embolization. What are the complications? Some pain is a fixed and the constant finding post embolization. Sometimes premature amenorrhea may occur in 1 to 2% of patients, infection in less than 0.5, and expulsion. And as I mentioned, some consider this as a benefit to uterine artery embolization myomectomy. And this is also a constant finding, what is called post-embolization syndrome in about 40% of the patient, fever, malaise, and it resolves within 3 to 5 days, and it is not a sign of infection, and the patient is not toxic. In conclusion, uterine artery embolization is a minimally invasive, safe and effective proven technique to treat fibroids. It is not an investigational tool. It is evidence-based medicine level A. It treats all fibroids simultaneously, because the patient is asking sometimes, it will treat one fibroid for all the fibroids I have. It is extremely effective in controlling bleeding in most of the fibroids, about 90%. It still can be offered for female wishing future fertility, and after full informed discussion and on a case-by-case basis. And the decision must be multidisciplinary to choose the best chance for the patient, whether laparoscopic myomectomy, hysteroscopic myomectomy, open myomectomy, or uterine artery embolization. And these are the fields for further interest for this issue, whether to do unilateral embolization in the female wishing future fertility or to do bilateral embolization, what are the best embolizing agents, and as I mentioned, embolization for large fibroids, and the most important issue, whether to do embolization for female seeking future fertility or not. This was our publication, the European Congress of Radiology, about a new approach for direct catheterization from the lateral uterine artery and uterine artery embolization. And thank you.